Dr. Snow Doxer and I covered office hours, and other than a little conversation with Mr. Brown, there was no takers this evening. Tonight, we're going to hear from a very impressive young woman from the community about a project that she completed over the summer. We're also going to be talking about an issue that's coming up at town meeting about some property abutting the school property here on Oakland Road. Dr. Doherty, you're going to tell us a little bit about a really interesting conference that you attended down in Washington, D.C. recently. Mm-hmm. I think Ms. Dowd is going to take us through some student activity account policy changes, and we're going to talk about telephones, apparently. And then we did get a parent inquiry a couple weeks ago, and we had a legal review done. It was a question about the legality of something, and decided, in the nature of transparency, to put it in the agenda so that information would be available to the full committee and the entire community. We have a consent agenda, we'll do reports, and I think that's it. We're not doing executive session tonight, so that's
it. We are not.
Wonderful. So, I would like to introduce.
I would not like to introduce.
Consent agenda.
Yes, let's do the consent agenda. Great idea. Do that a little out of order. Go ahead.
Yeah, reports.
So does anybody have anything they want to remove from the consent agenda?
Nope.
Sorry.
No, you're right.
Move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
All those in favor? 5-0. Well, that didn't take any time. That's the problem with the consent agenda. It's too efficient. I know I've got 4 reports.
Here she comes.
Oh, good. Yeah, the reports might be a little lengthy this evening. Oh, good. So I'd like to introduce Samantha Gibb, who's going to tell us a little bit about a project she did this year about buddy benches at the 5 elementary schools, right? Great.
Hi, my name is Samantha.
Hey, Sam.
Hi, Sam.
Thank you for having me at your meeting tonight. Last year, I worked on my server award for Girl Scouts. I needed to find a problem in my community to solve and make sure that it would always be solved. I decided to address friendship and inclusion. I raised money for a buddy bench to put at each elementary school and the Rice preschool in Reading. Dr. Doherty helped me so much and gave me permission to talk with the principles about my idea. Many people supported me while I worked on my project and made donations to help me achieve my goal. Mrs. King told me my story to a reporter at Channel 5, Erica Terradell, who came to interview me at Coolidge Middle School. Dr. Jody, would you please play the interview?
Absolutely.
Samantha Gibbs has shared that important message countless times. From the heart and part of her pitch to transform recess in Reading by installing a buddy bench at every elementary school.
My first thought was, oh my goodness, what a great idea. Why haven't we done this earlier?
Sam, who's just finishing eighth grade, brought her proposal to yes, the superintendent, all the principals, all the PTOs, and more.
I was really proud. It was,
And she really had to learn to read the presentation, which was great. And then see everyone else's faces in the room, how proud they were, Sam.
There really wasn't a dry eye in the room.
It was yeses all around to Sam's delight. She knows finding friends isn't always easy.
It was sometimes hard.
The way it works, if you're feeling a little lonely, take a seat. Someone else looking for a buddy to play with is bound to come over. The only rule, you can't say no.
You can't be picky about it. When kids get to third grade, fourth grade, they become aware of people who are different. And people are different in so many ways. And I think that a buddy bench would have been so helpful for Sam.
Sam had to raise the money, and she did. Clearly, her courage to ask inspired many to answer.
Complete strangers who we don't even know have sent in donations to Sam. And it's just been really touching.
I'm more excited about this project.
And you should be. You should be really proud.
Yeah.
This summer, all five benches are going in, and Sam will be making an instructional video with her friends to explain to all the elementary school kids how to use those great benches. Erica Tarantell, WCVB, News Center 5.
So after that, I got a lot more donations, and we were able to order all of the benches. We needed part of what I had to do for my project was make sure that the problem would be fixed for many years, for if not forever. So I asked Sean Callen to make a video of me and my friends. Dr. Darity, would you please play the video?
Samantha Gibbs, citizen of Reading and Girl Scout cadet, needed to find a problem in her community to solve in order to earn her silver award. Samantha wanted to address the issue of friendship and inclusion, so she thought a buddy bench at each elementary school and preschool in Reading would be a great place to start. The buddy bench is a place to go when you need to find help joining a group. When everyone learns how to use the buddy bench, it's a lot easier to join the fun. Rule number one, sit on the buddy bench if you want to find someone to play with. Rule number two,
when you see someone sitting on the bench, ask that person to play with you. Why am I staying on the bench? Look for a game you'd like to join. Then get off the bench and ask to play.
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Rule number four. the buddy bench?
Keep playing with your new friends.
And remember, the buddy bench isn't for sitting and talking. Use it when you need to find someone to play with, or when you see someone in need of a friend.
Let's go play.
Now the principals have the video to show their students at assemblies, and students will know how to use it. No one should be alone like I was sometimes at school. I hope that the buddy bench is a tool that all students will be able to use. Thank you again for having me and supporting my project. You guys have any questions?
Thank you for offering to answer questions. Anyone on the committee have a question for this project? Mrs. Webb.
Yes.
So I was wondering where you got the idea for the buddy bench.
Well, Miss King had a buddy bench. Well, Miss Kelly had a buddy bench, and she spray painted gold.
Oh, no. Mrs. Giles at Killam had a buddy bench.
Had a buddy bench.
Mrs. Kelly in Winchester had a buddy bench.
And I thought, how can this happen with my problem? And I thought about it, and I talked to my mom. And I decided I wanted to do it. And I was like, yes, I'm so excited. I want to do this and make a difference. And I love making a difference for everybody.
Excellent, Sam. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any more questions?
Samantha, oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
Yes.
So are the buddy benches are all paid for at this point?
Yes. And they're all at all the schools.
Great. Nice job.
I think this is such a wonderful contribution to our community, to our schools. You're building culture and friendships. Samantha, I'm just so inspired by you. I was wondering, have you heard many stories yet?
Yeah, I heard. Like, I heard, like, one time a kid needed to go on, and they told me that, wow, it was a wonderful experience. I want to do it again and again and again. I just love the bench.
That's awesome, Sam.
Great.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you for having me.
That was really wonderful.
Thank you for having me. Thank you, Mrs. Gibbs and Miss Gibbs.
She really is an inspiration. She's really an inspiration to the kids in this community. Mm-hmm. They can make a difference.
Thank you.
All right. We have to switch gears. I don't envy you, Mr. LaLasher, having to follow that. So I guess we're going to get a bit of a historical perspective on this Oakland Road property. And we will go from there. We'll call you up next. We'll let Mr. LaLasher have his go.
Right, I left your seat.
We'll give you guys neutral corners.
In your packet, there's two articles that are going in November town meeting, Article 16. They both relate to the book. The first one really has nothing to do with the school committee, but I wanted to show it to you just as context. The first one is going to town meeting. Town having thought they accomplished this 5 years ago. But that motion for town meeting discontinued all the public roads and needed to discontinue private roads. Past town council had just slipped up by a word. So technically, you know, if it's all, there are no public roads because there are no roads, they're all paper streets. So by definition, a paper street is really a private way. So this motion will clear up that. And in a very similar vein, Article 16, which does involve the school committee, was also approved 5 years ago by a town meeting. And on a technicality, town council said the map that was used was incorrect. This is a very arcane difference. You can't possibly see the picture, but we'll show you the difference at town meeting. Where the school committee had previously, after the high school project was significantly complete, the school committee had decided to declare this a surplus and not needed for any school purpose. I suppose fortunately, the selectmen several years ago discontinued the possible sale of Oakland Road pending the superintendent's discussion about all-day kindergarten and early education because there was a flaw in the map, and again, current town council has now found it and will rectify it with this article. So I would call both articles housekeeping. There are actions that town meeting and other bodies thought they had accomplished before, but this will really accomplish them.
And you said that the prior school committee had voted on this,
yes,
as well as town
meeting.
Prior
school committee had voted in a very similar fashion as to what you requested tonight, just with a different map, a different reference, same exact language otherwise. So as we've learned over the last several years, town council's finding a few things in the past that was not done perfectly well.
Understand.
And he's a stickler for detail. Had we sold the land, would there have been a problem? Probably unlikely. But once you find something, it's better to fix it.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Robinson.
So you'll find that there's three or four articles at this town meeting that are like this. They're housekeeping.
Move that the Reading School Committee determine that the real property shown as Oakland Road parcel on the plan land entitled Plan of Land Oakland Road, Town of Reading, prepared by the Town of Reading Department of Public Works Engineering Division, Jeffrey T. Zager, Director, DPW, Ryan Percival, PE, Town Engineer, dated September 13, 2016, is no longer required for school purposes and to give notice of said determination to the Board of Selectmen.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions for Mr. LaLasher? Oh, sure.
Okay, so I just want to make sure. So this map that we're looking at, sort of going over the article, is just calling out those roads as these were private roads, whereas previously, when we did this at town meeting, they might have been referred to as public roads.
That's for Article 15, correct?
Yeah. Okay.
But for your article, the roads don't really matter. It's just specifying the lots in the map that's shown that the one that you held up is right.
Okay.
It's
these two. All right. Oh, okay. I'm looking in the corner. The where the 1911 map would have had some very small lots densely populated in this area, it looks like to me. So okay. So it's this these corner areas.
Robinson?
I don't know whether you can say or not. I mean, is the plan to sell those lots? Or?
The selectmen will go through a public process, so they really haven't determined that yet. That's certainly one of the leading options. You know, the selectmen will probably create some sort of an RFP where this is, you know, the land situated where it is. We'll probably ask for ideas instead of coming up with an idea and saying, all of you that wish to fulfill this idea, off you go. So we'll just put out an RFP saying, here's the land, what's the use you would suggest? And those uses in the past, going back almost 10 years, have ranged, but they're generally in the you know, public purpose slash housing area. So one of the discussions that was 10 years ago was cluster housing at the time was popular, where you might have three or four buildings of three or four units each, for instance. I have no idea what the market will bear these days or what the best ideas will be. But I don't expect this to be a quick process. I expect this to take a year or two at least of public discussion and a lot of community input.
That's great.
And
this is, oh, sorry.
No, I and they've already tested the land and for ledge, and that's.
Yeah.
We actually did a couple of years ago, geotechnical study.
Oh, yeah.
And it is very buildable land.
It's very steep, but it is very buildable. There's not really any ledge or much ledge, so the steepness can be overcome.
So, I guess I have a question about sort of zoning and what kinds of things, if we even have in our bylaws or the state has, about what sorts of things can and can't be near a school. And I'm a little concerned about, but I guess we'll know before we sell the land what happens with question four and whether that's, has any potential impact, because there's some, that legislation appears to restrict the communities and the state's ability to sort of go against that legislation, so I'm a little concerned.
Right now, the only trump card to zoning is 40B housing. So even marijuana or medical marijuana cannot trump zoning. The town has zoned where that is allowed, commercial or industrial. So, Oakland Road right now is zoned residential.
Okay. So it could be public, but a public purpose, like?
If it's going to be anything but residential, it'll have to go through a zoning change and a public process, for sure.
So I'll be sure that that's a slow enough process.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Anything else from the committee? Mr. Brown, I think you wanted to speak to this issue?
Certainly.
11 years ago, I started my birthday. Then town manager gave me a birthday card, and inside it, and I'll quote, he says, "You're a pain in the ass, but you're our pain in the ass." And I'm sure by the time I get through this bubble, I'll feel the same way. No, you people got this property in 1947 on Article 22. And the reason that it got isolated in 53, they put the road in. So that's about it. Now, there was question as to the use. For the longest that I can remember, 1946, it was considered for a school. It was rejected. It's been considered for a fire station. It's been rejected. Police station, you name it. I think everything got a dog kennel, and it's been rejected. So I think it's time to put it back on the agenda. So, and town council's done a good job.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
I hope we get, huh?
Thank you for those comments.
Well, that's all right.
All right.
Can I just clarify?
Sure, Mrs. Smith.
Was it Oakland Road that went in 53? What road?
Yeah.
Oh, and then the high school started in 53?
Actually, they turned the corner in 53.
Okay.
Because Oakland Road, if you look through at that time, it went through to Tower Road. And then beyond Tower was Park. And if you look at, and you don't have the map, I do. But if you look at Tower Road, and as you go out the driveway, there's a little house there that sits on the right-hand side. I suggest that was Tower Road. And Mr. Enzinger's house is where Tower Road was. Because they, in. Yeah, in 53, they bought 5 additional lots of land to take care of the ledge. So we're added to the lot. And if it's done in a year, that's wonderful.
And just to be clear, it sounds like you're supportive of moving in this direction.
Oh, yeah, definitely, definitely. After, I went back to my town reports, and I made an instructional motion in 1985 to the Board of Selectmen to find out who owned it so we could get rid of it. So that's 31 years. I think it's time.
Yeah. Moving at the speed of light.
A snail.
A government.
Did you have something to add?
I did. Town council spent a lot of time in Cambridge at Land Court and found Mr. Brown's footprints all over the place. Really, they just redid some of Bill's work and a few things on their own, but Bill was very helpful in the process.
And the reason that the former town manager made that comment was that I went into the registry of deeds, and I think it's something like $7.50. I said, "Look, I'll give you the time, but you've got to give me the money." And he kept putting it off. So I kept bugging him until he got it.
Good for you.
Thank you. But is there anything else from the committee on this? Any questions? Any more discussion or debate, or are we ready for a vote? Ready for a vote? Okay, all those in favor? Passes 5-0. Thanks, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I neglected to call for public comment earlier, but we're kind of early in the meeting, so if there is anyone here who's wants to speak to an item that isn't on the agenda?
Not today, thank you.
Seeing none. Dr. Doherty?
Yes.
You're going to talk to us a little bit about what was going on down in Washington a few weeks ago.
Yes, and Mrs. Wilson will add some information as well as we go along. What I thought would be important tonight is to talk to you a little bit about the conference that Sarah Byrd, Carolyn Wilson, and I attended just about a month ago now. It was on September 19th. But also to show you some of the things that we discovered at the conference that we are heading in the right direction, and some other things that we're, like every other community, I think, are concerned about. So I've included some Reading data as part of this presentation, so that we can see the connection of the importance of the type of work that is happening all over the country, that these discussions are happening all over the country. So as I said, it happened about a month ago. It was on the it was at the White House in the Executive Office Building, which is in the south part of the White House area. There were 14 states that were invited, and the District of Columbia. We represented Massachusetts. There was about 200 attendees. We were invited because of the work we've been doing with behavioral health and trauma-sensitive education. One of our schools, Killam, is working directly with the Harvard Law Center, actually as a trauma-sensitive school, and has been doing a lot of work over the last year plus in that area. As you can see, there were several sponsors to the conference, including the Department of Education and the White House. So those were some of the highlights of the conference. And then going into a little bit of detail, there were several featured speakers, senior policymakers in the executive branch, starting with the United States Secretary of Education. He actually closed out the conference at the end of the day, John King. We also heard from the Assistant Secretary of the Office for Civil Rights. We also heard from one of the other sponsors, the Executive Director of the Georgetown Law Center on Poverty and Inequality. You could see from the list that there were a lot of senior policy officials to the president, as well as practitioners that talked about trauma in children. Mount Sinai Adolescent Health Center, Instructor of Pediatrics for the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. So you could see that this was a very rich conference in terms of the experts that and policymakers that were a part of it. There was also two panel discussions. One was a student panel discussion. This is actually the student panel discussion here in the photo, from students from various parts of the country that were talking about trauma and school discipline from a female perspective. And then we also listened to a group of experts who talked about trauma-informed approaches to supporting girls of color. The focus was on girls of color, primarily because they are showing across the country higher discipline rates and higher special education rates than other races and genders. But you can take the practices that were discussed at this conference and apply it to any student, any child. So the breakout sessions, which happened in later on in the day, which all of us attended different ones, you could see some of the topics that were involved here. Trauma-informed approaches for gender and cultural responsiveness. There was one on supporting schools to address childhood exposure to violence, school discipline disparities, particularly among race and gender. Transforming schools and implementation strategies, that's one that Sarah and I attended. Policy reform, which I believe Carolyn attended that one. I'm going to get back to the ACEs in a minute, because I found that a very powerful part of the conference that we learned a lot about. And then we had the breakout sessions. Reading was part of the region with New York, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania. Some of the questions at those breakout sessions, at the state breakout sessions, that we were part of the conversations included the, what are the leading types of trauma and risk factors that we know our students are experiencing? Our schools implementing trauma-informed approaches that can serve as a model for our state. What barriers or challenges exist in expanding trauma-informed approaches? So it was a very rich discussion. And then at the end, we reported out, and I'm going to show you a clip. This is actually of Sarah reporting out on our behalf.
Good afternoon, I'm Sarah Bird. I am here representing our district from Massachusetts. I'm here from Reading, Mass. But I also have the pleasure of being able to serve on our statewide Safety Support Schools Commission. So in Massachusetts, we are really blessed to have a lot of the policy at the state level in place and cleared away for districts. We have some laws that have been placed for the past few years that are going to help us really focus on our discipline, rethinking discipline. Our Chapter 222 is really the frame how a lot of our districts are approaching that. Additionally, we have a law that's all about building safe and supportive schools and requiring that every district has a safe and supportive school plan, district-wide and then building-wide, which is tremendous, and then it allows our superintendents and principals to be able to do the work. So at our state level, we really want to increase the emphasis on this topic. We've historically been very focused on the academics, even with building our multi-tiered system of support, which I've heard many of my colleagues speak about. It's been really truly focused on the RTI side of things, looking at the academics. And how do we interweave the PBIS, but also that overarching piece of how do you look at the embedding of all of them together? We've been lucky enough in Reading to have one of the School of Climate Transformation grants, as well as the Project Aware, so we're using the next 3 years that we have remaining to leverage that locally. And then how do we build capacity at our state level? And if we have three communities of practice in the state that have this time to focus on that as a priority, how can we inform at the state level so we can help build communities of practice regionally and make sure that people have peers that they can, you know, in education, beg, borrow, and steal from those who do the work already? So how can we do that for our colleagues? Similarly, we are really lucky to have the Safe and Supportive Schools Commission has put a framework together and a self-assessment tool for schools. And it's all publicly available and free for them all. And it was really started by Harvard Law's Trauma and Learning Policy Initiative. Susan Cole is here speaking in a couple of the breakout sessions from that. So when we're thinking about infusing trauma into things, it's nice in Massachusetts, it's kind of been the other way around, that the trauma work really informed our Safe and Supportive Schools framework. So how do we get back to our roots? I think we take that for granted, and I think we try to use this generic Safe and Supportive Schools, and we often use the trauma-informed side of things. So how do we continue to bring the attention back to that? And my last other thought is we have Lesley University brings the education to the educators. So instead of requiring educators who've gone through their education prep programs and haven't gotten any information on this, they've actually put professors all over the state to bring helping traumatized children learn four participative programs to our educators. So how do we continue to expand that program and share that with other students and share that with other communities so that everyone can have the
She was the only one that got a clap in all the presentations. It's interesting. So I should have set the context before I played the video. All of the people that were up there represented the different states from the breakout sessions, and then they reported out what was discussed in their regional meetings on behalf of their state. Sarah, obviously, she did a great job.
And John King, the Secretary of Education, was there.
He was in the corner listening. Right, he was off to the left. He was going to speak next, so he heard everything that we were discussing. I want to make a little bit of a shift to a topic that was very consistent theme throughout the day, and that was several research studies that have been done on what are called adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs. The initial study was done in between 1995 and 1997 by the Center of Disease Control. What was interesting about this study is that it focused on a population in Southern California of highly white, highly educated people. So they didn't look at the inner city, they didn't look at rural areas. They focused on a highly white, highly educated population in suburbs. And so what they did, and the, I have the links there, which I can send to you too if you want to take a look more at the study. But if you Google ACEs and SAMHSA or ACEs and CDC, it'll bring you to that site. The other studies have been built on based on this. So basically what an adverse childhood experience is it's a stressful or traumatic event that a child could go through, which could include abuse and neglect. And really it's divided up into three categories. There is abuse, which is emotional, physical, sexual. There's household challenges, where some examples is the mother's treated violently, or you have household substance abuse or mental illness, and or you have neglect. Those are the three categories, where you have emotional neglect or physical neglect. And what the study was showing is that ACEs are common. Almost two-thirds of the study participants reported at least one of these in their life, in their childhood life. More than one in five reported three or more. And what they were finding is that the total sum helps determine, could help contribute to some later problems in life. So for example, as the number of ACEs increases, so does the risk for the following. And you could see here a whole list of things. And they said, a child that had four or more ACEs during their childhood years has a greater risk of getting one of the seven leading causes of death than someone that had less than four. And so this was a very powerful study because obviously the children are going through the schools, they're going through these traumatic experiences for the most part outside of school. So what role can schools play in helping reduce that toxicity that could build up over time and lead to some of the risks that you see here. You know, some of the things that ACEs could lead to is early initiation of alcohol use, or higher risk of alcohol abuse as an adult, or tobacco use, or prescription drug use. And these are all things that we've talked about here in meetings here and through our CASA. And several questions that are in the Youth Risk Behavior Survey ask these types of questions about behavior. You also could see behavioral issues with increased ACEs, suicide attempts, lifetime depression, sleep disturbances, and so on. So, and this graphically shows that as your whole life perspectives get higher, that it could lead to some of these other levels on the pyramid. So some more results of the study that I found interesting is that 12.6% had four more adverse childhood experiences. At least 50% had one or more. There's a very strong association, as I said earlier. In terms of school, 51.2% of students with ACE scores of four or more had learning or behavior problems in schools. But even more interesting, if 97% of the students that had an ACE score of zero had no learning or behavior problems. So it really shows the impact that these adverse childhood experiences can have on learning and behavior issues and discipline issues in school. And a lot of this is the buildup. If you think of your body releasing toxins as they're trying to cope with these ACEs during childhood, if those toxins continue to build up, that's what's leading to some of this unhealthy choices or unhealthy developments or unhealthy risks later on in life.
And one of the things I want to add, which was an interesting perspective, is they talked about us as adults needing to be the buffer so that for some students, these stressors don't become that toxic stressor. The other piece to remember is that when you're looking at this study and we talk about these numbers, it's also reflective of us as the adults who are here to be the buffer for students. So we have to remember that the parents and the staff who are working with our young people may have also had these adverse childhood experiences. So they talked a lot about self-care, which is something I've really brought back to our therapeutic programs to help our staff. We've had a lot of turnover in those positions because they're working with some of our most challenging young people. And so we need to help our staff take care of themselves, and so that they can be that buffer, they can be that support, which was a big piece of what they talked about, is that we have to remember that all of us have had different experiences in our own lives, and we don't want that to necessarily flavor or impact the work we're doing with students who've had these experiences. And when I spoke to this with one of the teachers in the therapeutic support program, he said, can we really work on taking care of ourselves? I said, absolutely, because we want those staff to be present for those students, to be available to help them work through some of these things, so that if a student is experiencing this type of stress, we want the adults to be a safe place for them to go to.
Can I just,
sure.
So just back to the study, I know it said that many more studies were done.
Yes.
So I assume if we click on those links and we look at the studies, we would find, so that I would assume it's a much broader demographic of, mm-hmm. of
yes.
people than the original
yes.
study.
Mm-hmm.
And so you felt like it's sort of, it is representative. You're going to go into the Reading data now.
Well, the first study was done with a highly educated white population
right.
in suburban communities in Southern California.
Right, but these numbers here, like 12.6% had adverse experience.
That was the first study.
Oh, this is the first study.
Yeah, this is still that
okay,
first
so
study.
Okay, so this is the data from the first study.
Correct.
Okay. Well, then even bigger, wow.
I think Mr. Robinson had a question.
Okay. Carolyn, can you give an example? I mean, that was mm-hmm. interesting that what you were just mm-hmm. talking about, an example of what we're doing to help staff cope, I guess.
So a couple things we've been doing. Sarah Bird has been doing a lot with mindfulness, and she has been helping facilitate that with the adults in our community and helping them take those moments to have that mindful moment. I think she had a course this
she
afternoon.
She did. That was actually part of it.
And it was I think it was a packed room.
It was
my understanding this afternoon. It was an optional voluntary thing here this afternoon. The other piece is we've restructured the supervision for the staff in the therapeutic support program, as well as our counseling staff, to ensure that they have regular clinical supervision and opportunities to talk. And Sarah's been facilitating that clinical supervision so that people have a space to really discuss challenging situations, and we can address if people need more support, they need more training. We aren't waiting till the end of the school year to find out, oh my gosh, someone has been really struggling all year. We've really tried. So Sarah's been meeting with the therapeutic support staff in each building every week as a check-in, and then she facilitates a meeting with the administrative team at each of those buildings as well, so that the principals are hearing from those staff every month. So we're really trying to keep everyone connected and in the loop.
So I want to show you a little Reading data. Most of this is from the YRBS. One of the things that received back recently was some crosstab data from the YRBS that was done in 2015 of looking at it, the different groups and how they would answer, how the different groups answered the questions that were asked on the YRBS. So we broke it down. We drilled down even further from the original YRBS results that you saw the presentation. And actually, Erica showed some of this at the meeting, the annual meeting. So I highlighted some areas that I think are interesting that do connect to some of the things that we were learning about at the conference. So you can look at grades 11 and 12. You can see that the percent, the full sample, is the top line, but you can see 11th and 12th grade, those numbers tend to be higher than 9th and 10th grade. So as anxiety and stress continue to build as you go through your 4 years of high school, and expectations are increasing, you know, you see that the percent of feeling sad or hopeless or seriously considering the suicide. All of those suicidality questions that were asked are higher than in the younger grades. You could see under gender that females tend to have a higher percentage. And the other one was race and ethnicity, that students that are not white, you could see that their percentage, these are Reading students that we're talking about now, their percentage in this area are higher than white students. So I found that very interesting data. This is the 2015 data that, this is our latest data, and we're gonna be doing another round this in 2017 in the winter. We also looked at alcohol use. You could see, again, some similar trends that we saw in the previous slide. Females tended to be a little bit higher in the lifetime alcohol use and past 30-day use. Again, ethnicity, we saw that the all other multiracial groups tended to have a higher use of alcohol than white. And then we also did a crosstab with depression versus using alcohol. And to no surprise, those that are feeling in states of depression, various stages, are showing a much more higher use of alcohol. So you can see again the usefulness of seeing this crosstab data and breaking it down even further. Also taking a look at marijuana, I think again we're seeing similar results for females for the lifetime and past 30 day, other races, and system and symptoms of depression. Again, we're seeing the same types of data and increases that we saw in the previous two slides. And then this one here is a lifetime prescription drug use, and again, similar results, although the gap seems to be a little bit greater in these. The other piece of data I wanted to show you, there was a study done with the 2014-15 discipline data, which was the first year of the Chapter 222 law on suspensions and data, suspensions and discipline. And what we see here is the number of students that are being disciplined by race. And this is something that's a problem throughout the state. And we had two schools, actually. There are several districts that are showing greater than 10%, which is when you see that disparity of 10% or greater, that's when you need to take a look at your discipline practices and what are you doing differently. But you can see here for two of our schools at Killerman at the high school that the rate of black students being disciplined is higher than the state average. The gap, as you can see, between black and white race is also high. And again, this is one of the areas that they brought up at the conference. You know, what are our policies? What are our procedures? What are we doing differently? This is something over the last couple of years, before we even saw this data, that we have been looking at. And that's why we're putting in the PBIS system over the last couple of years with our multi-tiered systems of support and creating those common expectations for all students. But again, I wanted to show you this as well, that this is something that came to our attention this summer. Not, this wasn't a result of the conference, but this came to our attention this summer, and we've had some discussions, lots of discussions with our administrators about this. Some additional thoughts that we picked up during the conference at the different workshops that we attended. I already talked about the effect that trauma has on student achievement. That schools are our best opportunity to provide those safe learning environments. And I found a very interesting quote, and I made sure I captured it. Our children are not broken. It is our environment that has an effect on them. And that we as schools can have a powerful influence in reversing the effect that the ACEs, the adverse childhood experiences, can have on our kids. And there are some things, and this is something I know that Mr. Nyan has talked about a lot with health education and the prevention piece, but they talked about six things that we can incorporate into our students' lives to promote healthy living, which will help offset that toxicity that we were presenting earlier. Sleep, nutrition, exercise, mental health intervention, mindfulness practices, and healthy relationships. So those are some things that they promoted, that schools can have an effect in reversing this trend. Some other thoughts that came up: how do we address students with toxic stress? Instead of punishing the kids, teaching them, and this is the whole restorative justice piece that we've started to incorporate into our schools as part of MTSS. You know, trauma-informed model, treat kids the way they are, that they are treated. Putting those trauma-informed systems in place so that the whole culture of the school is focused on how to address these students in de-escalating these behaviors so that you don't end up with the disparities in discipline and that these kids are missing school, things like that. One interesting thing that came up, which I was shocked, was the role of the SRO in a lot of school districts. And the conversation that we had in our state meeting, and I got asked a couple of times, is how's your relationship with the police department? And they said, we have an outstanding relationship with our police department and our school resource officer. That's not necessarily the case in a lot of school districts in the country. And SROs are looked upon more as a disciplinary measure in a lot of school districts instead of a role model. And I found that a very interesting use of that position, because that's obviously something that we would never do here in Reading. And, you know, we've had some great SROs that have actually moved on to higher leadership positions in our police department. But the way that SROs sometimes are used doesn't help kids. It actually contributes to some of the trauma practices that we've been talking about.
I think it's such an issue in other parts of the state that there's actually been guidance by the Office for Civil Rights out to states about how to use school resource officers. Because it is
in other parts of the
country. Other parts of the country. Yeah.
Is the Massachusetts, I'm sorry.
Yes, go ahead.
Is the Massachusetts, is like our model more consistent with Massachusetts in general, or?
I think so, yes.
Yeah, so right from the get-go when we started this, it was such a richly collaborative process. And yeah, but I'm sure it really did. Some of it, in the very first way you do it, can often really set an important tone. So that's very interesting.
So I want to conclude by a couple of slides and, you know, how are we addressing this in Reading? And, you know, there are certainly a lot of things we walked away from feeling good that we are doing, that we were sharing, that I know other states, when other states are reporting out, they're not at the same place that our community is at. So we have several partnerships that are connected to our district. Sarah in the video talked about the Trauma and Learning Policy Initiative. We have a connection. That's how we have the trauma-informed school at Killam. Both Sarah and I are part of the Safe and Supportive Schools Commission, which gives us a voice in policy at the state level, which I would have to say that we have had some influence in the direction of the policy in what's been going on in that area. Leslie University has been offering trauma-sensitivity courses for our staff. 50 have taken the course so far. We've got another 40 enrolled for this year. So these are our teachers in our district that are taking these courses to help learn trauma-sensitive practices for their classroom. So we're starting to build that level of expertise in each of our schools. Certainly the work that we've been doing with our school transformation grant through MTSS, Restorative Justice, and PBIS, Those are things that we've been putting in place. Carolyn mentioned the mindfulness practices. That's being done with staff. Sarah is now offering on Monday after school for the next 8 weeks a mindfulness program for staff, which was very well attended today. In elementaries, we're using this in open circle. And actually, we're also using it in our preschools, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And in our junior high and health classes. Middle school this week is actually doing the Challenge Day activity. We have the youth mental health first aid training. That 50% is wrong. I was told today that we're closer to 80% of our staff are trained in youth mental health first aid. And one of the things that we have, and the grant has driven us in this direction, which is a good thing, is being able to use the data to inform our practices. So we're looking at internalizing and externalizing student behavior 3 times a year, which is the SRSS, SBIS. We started piloting the SBIRT this year in grade 9, which you're going to hear a report on that, but is going very well. And we're collecting office discipline referrals and suspensions so that we can see trends, when they're occurring, what time of day are they occurring, and then our health education classes, and hopefully after tomorrow we'll be able to offer more health education. But so these are the types of things that we're doing to address trauma in our schools. So we walked away feeling that we are on the right track, that we're moving in the right direction, that the things that we're doing are making sense for our kids. And you know, we were certainly honored to be invited. It was a very jam-packed day, but what we walked away with, I think, was some very important work. I did not know a lot about the ACEs study, and I did a lot more research on it, and was just fascinated by how that can affect all kids, no matter what community they're living in. And I felt that, you know, we also were able to share what we're doing and help other communities in other states learn from us as well. So it was very worthwhile, short, but a very worthwhile experience.
Thank you, Dr. Doherty.
Thank you.
And Ms. Wilson. Any questions on that?
Yeah. I just want to say I think I really appreciate the report and the thoroughness of the report. And I think it's really, you know, it's really important to be to get energized in that way, to be able to put out there sort of what you're doing and get that feedback. So I'm really happy. It was very short. It was probably hectic travel, a little bit tiring, mm-hmm. but it's so important because you get rejuvenated.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so talk about self-care. We have very limited opportunities, you know, I think, to provide you guys with opportunities like that. And so this is excellent. It just really looks like there's so many synergies to things that we're doing, resources that we have, and you know, hopefully we'll be able to leverage some of those. And as we look to goals for the next year, really informing those goals using mm-hmm. this experience and knowledge. So really thank you. So I think it's an excellent presentation.
Just a comment. It seems like, you know, and listening to all this and viewing it, that it sort of reinforces what we know from the national health standards that are more skills-based as opposed to knowledge-based. So I think that's going to be something we really need to look at, particularly when we put it into the middle school. And just, you know, maybe even have somebody come in that is an expert in the field and look at what we're doing and give us feedback on it. I mean, this is, as you know, such an, you know, important change that we need to make into students' behaviors, and behaviors don't change based on just content. It's developing the skills and anxiety issues that our students face these days. Teachers too, the results of standardized testing and everything that's gone along with No Child Left Behind, and even with Barack Obama's what am I losing that one?
Race to the top.
Thanks, Chuck. Race to the top. I've only said that about 1,000 times in my thesis. So, but anyway, so that was good stuff. But I really think we need to make an effort on making sure that our students are developing skills, not content, knowledge.
I have a question, Dr. Doherty. In the presentation, you talked about how schools can have a powerful impact on reversing the toxicity of ACEs, and that makes a lot of sense to me. But I also feel like there is a limit to what a school can
yes.
do. We can't reverse mental health problems. We can't stop a child who has an anxiety disorder from having an anxiety disorder. So could you articulate a little bit more where you see those boundaries? Where can the school improve the situation for students? And where is it kind of beyond the role of a school, and it really does have to fall to medical, you know, a child's family or medical practitioners?
I think we can provide the greatest benefit with the connections that kids can make with adults. In a lot of cases, you know, kids don't have that adult that they can go to. I think that's something that we have worked really hard on the last few years. That even though last YRBS, the trend has been going up, that there are people, you know, kids feel that they have an adult that they can go to in schools. And so I think that's where we can have the greatest impact. Certainly, a lot of the prevention and the skills that Mr. Nyan was talking about is another way we can help. But you're right, we're not going to be able to solve all the problems, but if we can put things in place that help minimize these other negative experiences for students, then that's going to provide them with an opportunity to learn. And that's the bottom line.
And to just add to that, the earlier we can address these issues,
yes,
the more likely we're going to have success with changing these behaviors.
I think the other role we play is also being a resource for families. So having resources available to share with our families, we make connections with them, with Elliott or other places for families who don't have food. Where can they go to a food bank? Really being a resource for families as well. Not just the student. I mean, I think our role with the students is very important, but also with the family and making sure that families feel welcome and see us as a resource to get them connected with the things they may need.
So there may be services the school system doesn't provide,
right.
but
right.
we can give them access to where
yes.
to access
yes.
yes.
that they need.
Yes, and be a sounding board, help them make those connections. I mean, we have families who don't speak English, so how do we help those families make connections with the resources in our community in terms of even pediatricians or other.
Thank you, Mrs.
So just to follow up on that just a little bit, so how would family, if their student is not in special education, let's say, how would that play out, that the family would be able to be connected to the right adult here in the school system, so sort of to get those resources? So you know, student is struggling, how would that sort of happen? Would that happen through the student's relationship with a particular teacher or
mm-hmm.
staff member
mm-hmm.
that then would, you know, lead to that contact at home? Is it, you know, I don't know, babbling,
I just
but
want,
I'm just
because this was sort of spurring up emotion in me also, that, you know, certainly there's certain things we can't provide as educators, as a school system. We
mm-hmm.
provide the access to things. But I also think, you know, I never sell short just the tremendous power we have in the environment that we create to show, you know, students the path, you know, the desire to want to take a certain path to succeed. I remember, I always go back, you know, over 25 years ago, as a graduate student and a beginning teacher in Los Angeles, and I remember a professor saying, you know, working with some very tough populations, and we would hear sometimes from educators, say things like, oh, these kids just don't want to learn. And I remember this professor pounding his fist down and saying, wants are learned. And it really brought home to me, as an educator, I have the power to create the want. And I think the environments that we create in our classrooms, especially as kids reach different developmental milestones, they create an awareness, they realize that they do want to succeed, and they realize that they have people supporting them if that's a path that they want to take. And so we're providing them the opportunities, and that's huge.
And one of the other things we'll review later, and one of our goals is putting together some more resources, so at each building there are resources, whether the nurse has them or our school the counselors, the principals, assistant principals know where can we connect families. It's just, you know, we need to pull together. We talked about this over the summer, needing to make sure that we have all those resources at our fingertips so that, you know, you don't have to be referred for special education, but rather we have those resources.
Yeah, I think one of the stronger parts of this presentation to me was how data-driven the approach we're taking is. And I think that that's helpful in terms of gaining public trust in it. It isn't a it's not a theory or philosophy, it is a data-driven approach. And you can actually tell if it works or it doesn't, because you're striving, to Mr. Nyhan's point, to change specific behaviors or specific outcomes that you can measure. So I would encourage you to keep, you're already doing it, but continue to go down that direction of having it be data-informed and continue to communicate that to us and to the broader community. I know that a lot of this is grant-funded right now.
Yes.
And it won't be in a few years, and we're gonna have to have a conversation about where the money comes to continue this work. And if we have data that shows that it's working, that becomes a much more powerful argument for it. So I would encourage you to keep going down that direction.
One more really quick thing is Craig's statement about want. Yeah, they have to learn that. I think, I don't know where the district was, it was the news recently where the attendance was really poor in the school district, extremely poor, and with the minority population and the, I don't know, the superintendent or principal sort of started knocking on doors and found out that the root cause was mostly that the kids did not have clean clothes to wear to school, and they were significantly embarrassed. And so, and some of the cases, part of the reason they didn't have clean clothes is because the electricity was off or the water was off. So the administrator said, come to school, bring your clothes, we'll wash your clothes. They installed washers and dryers in the school building and had sort of volunteered, but basically the kids brought in a thing of laundry in the morning. They went home with clean folded clothes so that they would come back to school the next day. And it was, the power of that is that, you know, you have to have the relationship with the student and then with the parents to then say, what's the barrier and how can we be a resource? Now, in that case, the school went, because of the financial situation of the community, really went beyond, right, and installed some capital equipment to take care of the problem. But when I heard that and saw that program, I was just so struck by sort of how simple the approach was. The administrator went out to the community and knocked on the door. And, you know, how you had to say, we can solve it. You know, and it did take some funds and some money, and they had to find the money. But it also made me very appreciative of where we all sit, mm-hmm. and you know what an incredible opportunity we have here. So,
thank you, Dr. Doxon.
I'm sitting here processing all of this after having spent 7 and some hours at Challenge Day today, which is a very powerful experience, which I think addresses the role of schools in reducing the toxicity. Thank you, of ACEs. And part of what comes up in my mind is a caution. I think that the data is really important. I think the studies that have been done are very important. I think that the relationships are not always linear in terms of what you put into a program and necessarily a direct result of that program. And I think that the constellation of programs and curriculum that we're doing work together to make that difference, which ultimately shows in the data, but not necessarily quickly, not necessarily directly. Things in terms of the Challenge Day, whether or not there's follow-up there, there's a lot of information that's gleaned about the students, about what their needs are, what their experience, what the staff is needing. And by the way, a lot of the staff, I think we're heading to the mindfulness afterwards.
There were several from Challenge Day.
It's exhausting. So I was thrilled. I almost wanted to sneak in. But I think that the experience of seeing, learning what kids are dealing with, what they're crossing. There's an exercise called Crossing the Line. Well, they're crossing the line when they come into the schools every morning, and they're bringing with them all of their experiences, all of the baggage that they're dealing with every day. And whether or not the data shows that this is improving. They're still coming across that line with this baggage, with this, these experience. I don't mean that baggage means they've done anything to deserve it, but they're coming with all these experiences. And so in a way, it challenges us to find other ways to deal with it if it's not that the data in the end is not reflecting the change. It doesn't mean we don't need to do things to address these issues. We just can't. It's just too clear from the data you're presenting, from what you see with the kids. It's too clear that they're bringing things in that are barriers to their learning. And to see the power of the realization between the children that other children and adults are going through or have gone through, what their experiences, what they're experiencing, it's very powerful. But it won't be a linear relationship between a program, a singular program like that, and the data on the behavioral change.
Thank you, Dr. Fox. Mr. Nye.
So one of the things that Jean brought up was, you know, what are we going to do afterwards? And I'm sure that we're going to start talking about a sustainability plan, how we can continue it. A lot of times, my experiences with grants and my experience as a grant evaluator is that you collect a lot of data, and then what do you do with the data? And there's got to be a map. And I think most importantly, we talk about this data-driven society now, and teachers are constantly being asked to collect data, but they need to know that the data that's being collected is going to be used, and it's going to change and make education an experience that's going to make, you know, obviously provide our students with a better environment in school, but also be more successful, and as well as making their jobs easier too.
I think we can move on. Thank you for the presentation very much. And congratulations for being selected to represent our state. I'm going to have, well, let's do a motion on the student activity account, and then we can go into an explanation of it.
Move to accept the first reading of revised policy JJF, student activity accounts.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Are you going to take us through this?
Yes.
Okay,
so
great.
Included, thank you very much. Included within the packet that you have all received is a revised copy, which we have included a marked copy. This reflects the various recommendations from the MASC as well as recommendations that came out of the audit from last year. So we have gone through to reflect the recommendations within this audit.
Yeah, go ahead, Ms.
So have some of the organizations that have the student activity counts, they've already been sort of informed of some of these changes, or sorry, I can't think about where I was recently where they were sort of talking about we don't take that kind of money anymore, it has to go into student activities.
So student activities are the school-based accounts only that we're talking about right now.
Okay. Oh, so do the PTOs actually?
PTOs are not part of this. PTOs are their own separate organization.
Do the PTOs raise money that goes into the school activities accounts? Student activities accounts.
A student activity account is when a student gives money for an activity and it's used for that activity. So a field trip, I'm going on a field trip, the money goes into the student activity account and the bill for the field trip is paid for out of that student activity account. What
was about field trip buses, which potentially previously, and actually elementary school was a long time ago for my kids, so but the PTO, maybe in the past the PTOs would have collected money for buses or had paid for a bus for something.
I think PTOs do provide some funding for field trip buses. That's correct.
Okay.
But that would not go into the student activity account.
Okay.
So this is, and this is money that when a parent writes out a check to, most of the time those are to the town of Reading or like class of 2017.
Yeah, so the prom, let's use the prom because that's
okay,
an easy example.
There you go.
So when you're going to the junior prom at the Danvers Port Yard Club, you pay an amount of money for the ticket. That ticket, the money for that ticket goes into the student activity account and it's used to pay the venue, the DJ, the meals, all that.
And so this is saying, what's the agency? Can you just explain the, like there's a hierarchy, the student activity agency account and then into the student activity checking account? I don't understand that. All funds received for student activity must be deposited in a student activity agency account. And no funds deposited directly into the student activity checking account except from the agency account. So
there's an account.
I'm sorry, I'm doing this on behalf of Gail.
So there is an account. All these funds are controlled by the town treasurer.
Okay.
Okay? So an amount of money goes into, you know, Coolidge Middle School has a student activity account. So funds are going in. There is an amount that there's a minimum, there's a maximum amount that can be in that checking account at one time. The rest of it sits in the agency account. And the only time the funds can be drawn into the checking account is when it goes below that amount that's been determined.
So like for instance, you, sorry.
No, go ahead.
You'd have the Coolidge student activities checking account, and then the money that comes in for student activities ends up going through the agency account, but then gets into the Coolidge account when
the treasurer, at the request of the director of finance, will put in an amount of money into that checking account, and that's, and the building principal and one other person, usually the assistant principal, signs those checks.
So like the money for the buses is collected field trip,
yep,
in advance of the field trip. The money goes into the agency account. It comes into the Coolidge account,
yep,
at the time that it's probably closer to the time that it's needed to be paid, to actually pay for the bus or whatever.
Correct.
Okay, I didn't understand the hierarchy thing.
So these aren't, but this isn't, this is field trips for student groups. It wouldn't be a school-wide field trip, correct, that you were collecting money for?
This
so
is
like
any activity
like
that, what we're talking about right now is middle school and high school.
Right.
Elementary school, the student activity accounts aren't really used.
But like a nature's classroom, would that fall under this? Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
It would.
That's not really how it's worded in the beginning, because that's not done by a student organization. That's done by the school.
Right. The school can be the student organization.
It can be?
Yep.
Student activity.
So just, I think I understand clearly. This is not the revolving accounts. It's
not
the fees.
No, these are
not
revolving accounts.
I just wanted to say that out loud.
This is a completely different set of Massachusetts general law.
Okay. So on the second page, it talks about the funds collected by classes, as in graduating classes, and so...
Yes, at the high school, that is correct.
It says that, if I read it correctly, that the class officers are in control of the funds that are collected at the end of the tenure of that graduating class, and then they have X amount of time, I think it's 6 months,
yes,
or something, to do something else with that money?
Yes, that is correct.
And one of my...
That's actually by recommended policy from MASC. I believe it's also in the law itself. It's in the Massachusetts general law itself.
And is that also... I know that each class has an advisor, so I assume that the advisor is guided to help them put it into an account or something that has a counter signature, to make sure that we know where those funds are going after a class graduates. Are there controls on that?
Once the class graduates, then a decision has to be made with the remaining funds.
And that.
And it's the class officers that make that decision.
And so those funds can be, sorry, those funds, I'm just thinking back. So those funds might be saved to seed future reunions.
Could be, yep. Or it can be donated as a gift back to the school, which that's been the case as well.
And so is it usually that all of the funds are donated back as a gift, or are there funds out there that the school no longer has any control over that?
The school loses the control once the class graduates because it's not their funds, it's the students' funds. Because remember, this is a student activity account. It's not a school account.
No, I get that. So where I'm coming from is that all of these students pitched in for their graduating account, and then a few officers were elected, and then they decide where that money's going to go. And I'm asking, there are two questions. One is, what are the controls that it doesn't go into someone's personal checking account, I guess, is one of my questions. And then the second question is sort of a leading question. I'm wondering about thoughts I have, and I've discussed, not with school committee members, but just in passing, about the benefits. Actually, it came from a creative problem solving. The juniors did a project on alumni, engaging alumni, and whether that money might be, if it's not used in that 6 months, whether that could go into an account designated for alumni programming.
So I think the first question we better clear up right away. What are the controls in place so that nobody can drain that fund and put it into their personal checking?
It says right here.
We are limited. We can definitely look into this, but we are limited to what the law says, because it's student activity. This is not a revolving account. This is
sure.
So I think that's the important point here, is that, and this is a practice that has been in place in the laws, and MASC has actually recommended this practice as well.
It's
their money.
Right.
It's the student, the class of, 2016, it's their money. It's
but
not Reading Memorial High School's money.
It says it has to go into an account of the class of 2016,
right,
and it cannot go to an individual. So,
okay,
right,
the
so
officers.
It says it in there.
Sorry.
Can I just, are the officers the four primary officers? I mean, the class officers are 12.
It's the president,
it's the
vice president, treasurer.
It's that the core four,
yes,
officers,
yes,
that would be, that have to have a copy of this policy, know what their duties are, and then they would have to either set up, if I hadn't read this right, they would have to set up an account to the class of 2016 somewhere, or they basically forfeit the money back to the school. Because you're only going to write, this says you can only transfer it to that account.
Correct.
So
a lot of times they do it as a gift back to the school.
Right.
And they may save, say $1,000 for their first reunion or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
To seed money for the reunion.
So there would be no process for an alumni.
This is just a housekeeping, cleaning up a
this
policy
is something that
that's been working for a long time.
Yes.
So
this was never in your policy,
right,
which is what the audit was saying, is that we don't, there was nothing in the policy about this.
Was
but it was
anywhere?
A practice that was happening.
That's been going on,
yeah,
for years.
This was to address the comments,
uh-huh,
that,
right,
came out
of the audit.
So one of the audit recommendations,
okay,
was update your policy appropriately.
Yeah, yes.
That makes sense. I have a question on number three. Authorize the student activity checking accounts for use by the principals with specific maximum balances. It used to read established for each school by school committee, and now it says established annually for each school by vote of the school committee. Is that something that we need to, sounds like, get on our annual agenda?
Yes.
And that is a change?
Yes.
Okay, so that's something that we'll have to do. So presumably when that time comes, we're going to need a list of all the accounts with the current maximum balances and then engage in a discussion about that. So that's a change that will... That
you'll do a maximum balance per school.
Okay.
And I think right now, if I'm not mistaken, the high school's 50,000 and the two middle schools are 25.
Mm-hmm.
Because the high school has a lot more volume.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Because they have more activities.
All right, well, this was a first reading. We'll be coming back again and doing a second reading. Any other questions or comments for this evening? No. Okay, we have a motion and we have a second, so no more questions, discussion. All right, we're ready for a vote. All those in favor of the first reading? 5-0, it's unanimous.
Now we're on to...
Oh, we forgot to dispense with the reading.
It's the first reading, it's okay.
There we go. Disposal of surplus equipment. Also you missed that one.
Second reading, and item, so we have replaced the phone system at the Coolidge Middle School. So what we are, as indicated in the memo, what we're asking the school committee is to declare the old Comdel system as surplus property such that we can move forward with disposing of it. So it was approximately 15-year-old system that was replaced.
2000. And in the memo on October 13th, the date of October 13th, you explained the process to go through with this. You first offer it to other departments within the town. And then if nobody in the community wants it, it's offered for sale to other school districts, and then donations to nonprofits. So there's a policy that you follow.
There is a policy and steps we follow through, including presenting it as part of the town meeting to be full disclosure that we have the surplus. So that is, that will be slated, and then we will walk through the rest of the steps.
It's always one of my favorite town meeting articles, is surplus property. Okay. Mr. Robinson.
Move to declare the old Coolidge phone system as surplus property.
Second.
Any other discussion or questions? We're ready for a vote. All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you. Dr. Doherty, we got a question several weeks ago from a parent in the community about Ms. Wilson's role, wondering about the sort of compliance with all necessary laws for our Director of Student Services position. And we made the decision together that the right thing to do with a question of that level is to get a formal legal opinion as to it. So could you walk us through, not all the details.
I was going to say, I don't know if you want me to.
I mean.
Michael Joyce's legalese.
Yes. It is a very long memo in our packet for people who want to get into the rationale behind it.
So Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 71B, Section 3A, provides that a school district which has an excess of 4,000 students, such as Reading, the school committee shall appoint an administrator of special education, and that individual shall devote full time to the duties involving in supervision, I'm reading the law, provision of all special education in the school system. So Michael Joyce, who is our, from Nuttall, McAvoy, and Joyce, who is our legal counsel for student services, gave us a very detailed explanation, as you can see here, essentially saying that there is no legal justification for the interpretation of this law. And then he goes into detail defining what full-time means, which I did find interesting that full-time, according to the Internal Revenue Service, is 30 hours. Mm-hmm. And so I think I can safely say that Mrs. Wilson puts in more than 30 hours of time devoted to special education.
Roughly half her time.
Yeah, right today.
But I think the more important point, which Michael goes into detail, is that although she's the Director of Student Services, and she does oversee other areas such as health services, English language learners, and I'm trying to think, there's one more I'm missing. No, health services.
Health. Yeah.
There are other people that oversee the day-to-day operations of those services. Mrs. Wilson's role is to supervise those supervisors. So for example, we have a Director of Nurses. Who is the one that oversees health services in our district? Mrs. Wilson is her supervisor. So Mrs. Wilson maybe meets with her once a month, mm-hmm. maybe twice a month. I actually also meet with Lynn when we're doing areas outside of such as ESPRT, things like that. With ELL, we have an ELL coordinator, mm-hmm. which is a teacher but oversees the coordination of ELL services in our school district. Mrs. Wilson, again, probably meets with her once a month along with the other ELL staff. So the amount of time that she's putting into those other areas is much less than, well, much less than 30 hours, but there isn't as much time because there are other people that are supervising those areas. Mr. McAvoy also talks about the fact that you can make an argument that a lot of these other areas that Mrs. Wilson does oversee can be connected to special education, and really need to be, because a lot of times those students are in special education. So that in essence is the details of the memo. You know, essentially we are not in any non-compliance of this law.
And I think that's also the important point. When someone brings up an issue of compliance, we take it seriously and get a legal opinion. Right. So that's another thing I certainly want the community to take away. Any comments or questions on that?
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
So was this specifically provided to the person who?
I spoke with a parent in question and provided a link to the packet with the information on what page it could be found.
Okay.
And actually did follow up with a conversation. So yes, the specific questioner. But I also feel like when a parent questions something like that, the whole committee should be aware of it and the broader community as well. So that if this issue were to come up again in a few months, it won't be, we're not answering the same question multiple times.
The description of your duties is quite detailed, and I appreciate that, you know, at least I can understand a good portion of this that's in layman's terms, not just the legal interpretation of all the aspects of Mass General Law that describe full and whole time.
Thank you, Mr. Joyce, for doing it.
Yeah.
I think that's it until just reports.
Yeah.
All right. Let's hear from our students. Do you believe it's almost the end of October?
No.
So we have a bunch of stuff going on. The first thing is this Friday, the Latin department is hosting a classics day. So we are inviting students from Penguin Hall to come to the high school and participate in this all-day event with any students from the Latin program who wish to do so. Latin students are creating crafts and activities in the cafeteria and outside to teach their classmates different things. It's going to be fun. We've been working on it for a while. Also, the symphonic band is going to the Boston Symphony Orchestra on Thursday. The wedding singer, this is the drama club's newest musical, is being performed on the weekend of the 11th and the 18th of October. Then the robotics team is building a t-shirt cannon, and they will be displaying this at one of the football games. They're very excited about it. And they're also hosting a science expo day on November 5th at Coolidge. Anyone can come. And lastly, the National Honor Society is collecting non-perishable food items on Halloween. So if anybody would like to help out, maybe have some ready, and the trick-or-treaters come by, and they'll come and collect them.
Thank you.
Well, recently, this is the one thing. This Saturday, we're the PSATs for the summer.
This past Saturday.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. At least it's over.
Yeah.
You can say that. Great. Thank you both. That's great. Liaison reports from the committee. Dr. Doxer.
So as I said, I was at the, I'll say first of all, Mrs. Wilson is going to give the report for the CPAC.
Great.
Thank you. I said before that I was at the challenge day today, which was a quite impactful day for me and for the students, talking to Marlene Lipschitz, who was the motivation behind getting this program here 3 years ago. It had a pilot 3 years ago, and then last year it was held for all of the eighth graders at both of the middle schools, and the same for this year. And she summarized that the impact of the day was the empathy, love, and I got your back, which was felt by the student. It was clearly, there was just an energy in that room. All of the eighth grade, the half of the eighth grade participated today. Tomorrow, the other half will participate. The comments back were people listened to me, I wasn't alone. They were being very real with one another. It's a very high energy day. Mrs. Lipschitz emphasized that this was only one piece of the ways that kids are being engaged for level one MTSS with the social emotional learning. So they're having follow through in their choices class, they're reading together, all the eighth graders are reading together the book, The 13 Reasons Why, which I highly recommend if your kids are reading it, or even if they're not, you read it, or it's a great version, there's a great version on tape. And that book really emphasizes the choice points that kids make, people make, that could influence someone's life. It's a very, very powerful book, and the eighth graders will be reading it.
What was the title?
It's 13 Reasons Why. They also have the elective project adventure, which is like an experiential counseling experience. They have pre and post activities to Challenge Day, as well as when Michael Fallon came. And in terms of the concrete skills, they're organizing a Be the Change Club, so that children can, the students can actually work on how they can be the change, what skills they need to develop. There'll be laminated reminders of some of the sayings that they worked with, some of the activities that we put around the school. This is at Coolidge now. I did not go to Parker, so that starts, is it Thursday and
Friday?
Thursday, Friday. And I was just looking to make sure that I didn't. Oh, and also to experience this vicariously, you can look on the website. There are tapes, there are videos that you can look at to just get a glimpse at what the program is like. But if you'd like to be a volunteer, they need adults to make this happen, because you need a certain ratio of adults, student to adult, in order for this program to be available for all the eighth graders. And Sarah Marchant had said that if anybody's watching and interested in tomorrow morning, they're glad to have you email her tonight or just show up tomorrow morning. You do need to be queried, but you do not need to be fingerprinted, because you will not be alone with the students. But really, there's no words that really capture the experience of that day that I've had three times now, and each time has been very different and meaningful. So I just wanted to, and many thanks go to the private anonymous donor who has provided the money, and the PTOs who have paid for the travel and the hotel for Katie and Tim, who are high energy and very effective facilitators for this program, in my opinion. And in terms of follow-up, if there are any concerns, then students are followed up after this activity.
Thank you, Dr. Dawson. Yes, go ahead.
Just one thing, really important sort of display slash event at the community room in the police station was today, or tonight, tomorrow, and Wednesday. It's called Hidden in Plain Sight. It's basically a recreation or a mock-up of a teenager's bedroom. This is recommended for adults only. It gives parents like myself and ourselves an opportunity to sort of go through a bedroom and learn what everyday objects might not be so everyday and might be an indication of substance use or substance misuse. And so it's come to Reading, it sort of travels around the state to different communities. I know the Mission of Deeds donated some of the furniture. Again, it's at the police station in the community room. And tomorrow it's open from 2:30 to 4:30, and then from 6 to 8 p.m. And then Wednesday it's open 8 to 11 a.m. And again, it's really just adults. And I really highly recommend it. We have a lot of dialogue about some of the substance use and misuse issues that we have in the community, and the kinds of things that we're doing from our hopefully looking to put in our health curriculum in the middle school again, the youth mental health first aid. Those programs have been offered to parents. I know Linda and I both took that program, adult mental health first aid. There's also you know, a number of programs that RACASA continually puts out, and film screenings. And I think it's just really important, because we don't know what we don't know. It's totally different than when we were kids. And frankly, if you, as an adult, went through your life and you didn't use any substances, alcohol is a substance, so, you know, maybe we have experience with that, then I think it's very easy to think, not my kids, not my house, not my kids. And every time RACASA has an event, there's parents there that wish that they could have their kids back, that they had taken more time to understand that it very well could be their kids and their family. So I really encourage people to try to find the time to get there. It's called Hidden in Plain Sight.
Thank you, Mrs. Babb. It's a great event, and it is over the next 2 days.
Yep. Just wanted to add to that there is a mental health first aid for youth coming up. I believe it's Saturday, November 5th. And I'm signed up, and I'd love company.
Any other reports from the committee? I have a couple tonight. You were good?
Nope.
Okay. The REC committee met last week on October 11th. And I'm guessing everyone in this room knows, but our director of recreation, John Fudo, has resigned his position with Reading. It's a huge loss to the community. Not everyone in the room knew. He's been here for very many years. He's an institution in the town. It's an enormous loss. He will be taking over as the executive director of the YMCA.
Awesome.
So he has, the good news is the community gets to keep him, but in a different role. So a big loss for us as a town and a community, but a real asset to the YMCA. He's going to do a great job over there. His assistant, Jenna Fiorenti, is taking over the responsibilities of recreation for now. So anyway, that's a pretty important staffing update. A lot of great events coming up. Downtown Trick or Treat, third annual, is Wednesday, October 26th from 4 to 5:30 p.m. Cannot recommend it more highly. Even if you don't have kids, get yourself down, grab a cup of coffee, and just sit on a bench and watch the hundreds of big hundreds, not little hundreds, hundreds of kids running up and down, trick-or-treating. The local businesses are so supportive of this. I mean, it's just really a special community event. It's really fun.
Gee, what day did you say?
It's Wednesday, the 26th, and it's 4 to 5:30, which is nice, daylight hours.
Okay.
The businesses are open, and it's a really super fun time. I go every year, and it's great. Also, for younger kids, that's up to age 13. On Sunday, October 30th at noon, over at the Coolidge Middle School, there is a costume parade, another annual event that's really fun. At our recreation committee meeting, we also had a presentation from the Friends of Reading Rec, and just the amount that they do is really impressive. So coming up, the PSATs this past weekend, it's already happened, was the annual mother-son flag football game, which was, I have a friend who participated with her son, and just so fun, great time. Starting in November, annual Sunday morning, adult pickup soccer and basketball games at Wood End. Over this winter, there will be various Sunday afternoon open family gym nights at the field house, which is, if you've got kids at home who need to burn some energy, just bring them to the field house and have some fun as a family. And then in May, they are doing their annual daddy-daughter dance and the annual poker tournament. So, and also I should have mentioned this. They have started recently in the last few years a middle school cross-country team, and they have 109 kids doing that right now. It's been tremendously successful. I think track as a sport plays a real special role in sports in the community. Not every kid is great with a ball and loves to throw and hit and kick, but they want to get exercise, they want to be in a team, and track is a way to do that. I'm thrilled our middle schoolers have access to a high-quality track program. So that is it from the Recreation Committee. Included in your packet tonight, I included an update, really just a reminder of our operating protocols. Because we haven't had a new election, so it was the actual, the six of us, who created and approved these last year through the MASC program, the Mass Association of School Committees District Governance Program. We sat down, learned about best practices, reviewed our protocols, created and approved this list. So just, we haven't looked at them in about a year, probably a good idea to remind yourselves, particularly around information requests and communication, and making sure that you're following what we all agreed to as protocols. And two quick things, something certainly that's come up in the community that I've heard in the last week that I wanted to address is confusion in the community about the meeting we had last week jointly with the Board of Selectmen and the litigation, the tentative settlement with TLT, happening at the same time as the override, and a little bit of concern that was intentional. So I just want to reiterate again, I said it last week, I'm gonna say it again, the timing of those two things were completely independent and completely coincidental. There's nothing more to be said there, but there was no intention at any point to have those happen at the same time. They did. I think it's unfortunate that they did, but they did, and they were completely independent of each other. And I wanted to make that statement again. And my final report is really an acknowledgement. I'd like to congratulate Dr. Doherty. Since our last meeting, he was awarded with the Patrick Scatini Award from the Middlesex Partnership for Youth, which falls under the Middlesex District Attorney Office. It's given every year to a superintendent or fire chief or police chief in Middlesex County who has excelled in coordinating community efforts to stem substance abuse and create safe and supportive schools and communities. So it's a real honor for you, and it's a feather in your cap, but also reflects well on the community and our schools. So congratulations, Dr. Doherty, on that. I never have that many reports. That was it for me tonight. Okay, over to the staff. What have you got for us tonight?
I'm good.
Okay.
No more surplus property.
So I have a bunch of things on my report. I wanted to start off with something that is not special education. This Wednesday, October 19th, our ELL department, our English Language Learner teachers, are hosting a parent coffee in the morning for our parents. So this is just another type of outreach that we're doing with our families. Their goal this year is focusing on parent outreach and getting parents who don't speak English to become part of our school community. So they're going to be hosting a number of coffees throughout the year. So the first one is coming up. And the other piece I wanted to let you all know is that we have hired a team chair for Joshua Eaton. Amy Benjamin will be joining us starting next Monday, the 24th. Amy is coming to us from the Department of Education. She worked in the unit that's called Program Quality Assurance. It has a new name now that I don't quite have down, but basically that's the group that comes out and does compliance reviews of school districts. She's been with that unit for 4 years. She also has experience as a guidance counselor and elementary school teacher. So we're excited to have her joining us at Joshua Eaton. So the CPAC update. They had a meeting. They have a new board. So our new board members are Melissa Davis, Tara Giardina, Kate Goldlust, Gina Moran, Terry Texera, and Alicia Williams. So they were able to elect a new board, so that's exciting. On October 25th, we're having our next CPAC meeting, which is going to be on anxiety and school performance. And we have we're utilizing the Middlesex Partnership for Youth. They have a presenter who will come out. So that will be in this room on October 25th at 7 o'clock. And I have will be working with the new board to schedule regular meeting times with it's going to be a rotation of different board members coming in to meet with me. I've been meeting right now with Alicia Williams every other week. To just connect with what's happening on the parent front and just maintaining those open lines of communication. So the next piece I wanted to share with you, this I'm not going to take credit for creating this. Dr. Doherty created this, but one of my goals this year is going to be to report out to you on the Walker Report recommendations. So Dr. Doherty created the template, and I, throughout our different meetings, will take different areas of the recommendations and just highlight the percentage of completion and any comments that I have on that. So this is just the blank template, just so you can see the recommendations. And throughout this school year, in my reports, I'll highlight different areas for you just to give you an update on that.
Carolyn, that's fantastic. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you, Dr. Doherty.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
The for the CPAC meeting, anxiety in school performance, it seems to me that that might actually have a broad appeal.
Mm-hmm.
Is that meeting open
to all
anybody?
The meetings are open to anyone. We're actually doing we're communicating out to the whole school community. So
and it's going to be here.
It's going to be here. So professional development updates. We, as I had mentioned before, three of our special ed teachers have completed at the high school have completed the Wilson introductory course, and one of those special educators has expressed a willingness to complete the Wilson level one training. So we're working to get that set up for her, which is very exciting news. We also
last Thursday and Friday, October 13th and 14th, we had a two-day training. We had 40 teachers from high school and middle school that attended this training with the Landmark School, and it was on understanding students with specific learning disabilities and teaching executive functioning skills. So it was 2 days. The teachers were there for 2 days. We had content area teachers. We had some of our co-teaching pairs from the high school, so special educator and content area teams that were working together for 2 full days, and I think it went very well. I'm waiting to get the evaluation sheets back, but overall I think it was a great 2 days. Staffing update, so high school staffing update. Mr. Barker will be sending out a letter to parents soon. We have finalized the hiring. We have 2 school psychologists that we were waiting for some paperwork for, but they have started. So it's a 1 full-time and a half-time school psychologist that we're excited about having joining us. We have utilized the agency. We had talked about Delta T as a staffing agency. We have used them to provide us with a special ed teacher who has training in Wilson and Orton-Gillingham, because we feel strongly we need that position. We can't have it just continue to be vacant. So we're using the staffing agency to fill the position right now. We're keeping the position posted, but we have someone from the staffing agency who has joined us, who's gonna be teaching reading, who is able to do some co-teaching, and she's also supporting one of our learning centers. And then finally, we have filled the team chair position at the high school with Jane Finger. Jane was with us 2 years ago at Coolidge, and when we increased to full-time, she wasn't really looking for that, so we've brought her on as a 0.7 team chair at the high school, which she's someone who's familiar with how we operate. Jane is certified as, she's licensed as a special ed administrator, she's also licensed as a special ed teacher, licensed as a reading specialist, so she brings a lot of experience with her, as well as knowing some of our families from Coolidge. So I think that is it online.
So you mentioned it. So we are bringing in someone to fulfill that reading
yes.
Teaching position, and they're going to be able to take the complete caseload, so there shouldn't be any.
We're kind of divvying up some of it, because now we have some teachers who've had the initial training. She's taking on some of that. We're going to utilize Jane's expertise as a reading specialist to do some consultation and sort of help support that. But we're still looking, because the person we've hired isn't certified in Wilson. She has the 30-hour training, the introductory training, so we're keeping the position open.
Sure.
But the temporary agency person is?
She is not, no.
Oh, she's not.
She is not. She has the training. She's licensed as a special educator. She's received training, but she is not certified in Wilson. But we felt that continuing to keep a position vacant and not
right.
servicing kids
mm-hmm.
at all, it's better to have someone who has some training and can provide services to students than to not have anyone at all. And so this way we can continue to post. And by utilizing an agency, we also have
that's
the
better.
Freedom to
mm-hmm.
let someone go if it's not a match, or if we do find the right match. And Jane comes to us with a background as a reading specialist in her role as team chair, so she can also help with that, kind of overseeing that and looking at the program design.
Thank you, Mrs. Olson.
I'm good for time.
I have a couple of updates. Gave you some additional documents this evening. The purple document is on October 1st. That's kind of a day that we have to report to the state our enrollment for the year. It's the official date that's used by the state. So you can see this is our enrollment as of October 1st at all 3 levels. If you flip to the other side of the purple sheet, you can see how it's compared to from last year. The biggest change you can see is at the elementary, where we had a decrease of 68 students, and that really is because the kindergarten was much smaller. That's the biggest reason why. If you remember last year, our kindergarten was actually higher. Middle school's up 17, high school is down 1. So they pretty much stayed the same. So that's where we are with our October 1st enrollment. the yellow breaks the elementary down by classes, so you can see the class sizes. Even with our budget cuts that we had this year, our class sizes are holding pretty well. There's a couple of spots that are a little high, but 25 is the highest, and that's in the grades 3 through 5 range. And for the most part, our K to 2s are in good shape. Any questions on that?
I do. I have a couple. You mentioned that the grade 8 to 9 enrollment is down 31 students. Is that a typical number?
Yeah, it's about 10%, 9-10%.
That's what you see
yep.
typically every year. My other question is about the fifth grade class as a class across the district is relatively large relative to other classes. Do you have any concerns about them transitioning into the middle school given they're not an astronomically high number, but a little bit higher than typical?
I don't at this point. We did have a large class come through. I think it was about 390 a few years ago.
The senior class.
Yeah, the current senior class.
Yeah.
And we did not add staffing at the middle school for that class.
And that was 390.
A lot of it has to do how it's broken down geographically, and that's something that we're in the process of starting to do.
Are there anything else from the committee? Thanks, Dr. Doherty.
I have more.
Oh yeah, keep going.
The blue is we've had two Jewish holidays. So as I did last year, I wanted to report out the attendance. These are students and staff only that were out because that had notified us that they're out because of the Jewish holiday. This is not the entire attendance. So you can see that. On the first day of Rosh Hashanah, which was October 3rd, there were 38 students across pre-K through 12, which is about 9% of the total student population. We had 8 staff out. The second day of Rosh Hashanah was a little bit lighter, as you can see, much lighter actually. And then The Yom Kippur, which was last week, we had a similar amount as the first day of Rosh Hashanah, 37 students. And just so that you're aware, the average daily attendance in our district is 96.5%.
Could you say, I'm sorry, could you repeat that, the average?
Right here.
It's right there, 96.5%.
Yes, go ahead, Mr.
Is this, you may not know.
Oh, it's not, no, that's 0.9%, sorry.
I was just pulling out my calculator for.
Sorry,
it's like
0.9%.
Thanks.
0.1%.
And it's 0.1%.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Is this consistent with last year? Do you remember?
Yeah, pretty much. It may be a little bit lower, but there isn't that much difference. We did, and I think you received some emails as well from some parents with the implementation of the policy. So I've actually met with one of those parents today, and it really comes down to the actual implementation of the policy that's the issue. It's something that we will be continuing to work on this year. So
good. We'll probably want to relook at this data when we look at the school calendar.
Yes.
Yeah, Mrs. Webb.
So when we do that, I just would like to make sure that we have more of the full picture of the attendance data, because what was the overall absence rate on that day? It was 0.9%, but was it, you're saying there was, so the 0.9% would be within the 3.5% overall?
Yeah, I can get that. No, that the 90s, I just wanted to put it into perspective for you what the average daily attendance is in our
right.
school district.
Right.
That's
so,
every day.
Okay,
so that's
I understand. So that's 3.5% absence rate every day then? Or am I not? That's if the average daily attendance is 96%. That's
correct. 96.5%.
So 3.5% absence rate.
For the total student population.
Right, for the total student population. And so assuming, so then 9.9% of the typical 3.5%. Is what this represents here.
Correct. I can
okay.
get you the actual day
attendance. Yeah, I mean, just when we
if we're discussing it
Right.
in any other format.
I actually agree that that would be interesting to look at. If you saw what's less the attendance rate, but the absence rate, and how does the absence rate on those days compared to the week before and the week after. I think that's a good idea.
Right, I think we need more data to look at to make any, to draw any conclusions, that's all.
And certainly look back to Good Friday. By the time we vote the calendar, Good Friday, I don't think will have happened. But
yeah,
we could look at the Good Friday data from last spring.
Good Friday was a little bit different. There was a lot of dismissals on Good Friday around noon time.
But I'm sure there's a way to capture that.
Yeah, I think there is. We can look at that.
Thank you.
I'm not done yet.
Couple other things, actually one other thing. Starting next Thursday for 2 or 3 days, the Massachusetts School Building Authority will be coming through all of our schools to do a walkthrough and to meet with the building principal and the director of facilities. They sent us last week a 6-page questionnaire that we have to fill out, ranging from square footage to number of classrooms to what was the school originally built for, this, the age of the school, all of those things. I think I had told you when in the spring that this was something that was going to happen. We just didn't know when it was going to happen. So it is happening next Thursday, possibly the following Monday and Tuesday. But by mid-November, all of it will be done.
And is that happening statewide?
Every school in the state is what I was told.
And do you know
when? It takes about 3 to 4 months.
And that, so when will they publish the results?
The summer.
Over the summer?
Yep.
Okay.
And what they will do is they will give each building a rating, which is one of the factors that will be used when a community is looking for funding from MSBA for a school.
Does the as part of that questionnaire, like the capital plan, like what would they be looking at? What things, part of the questionnaire is, you know, what things are you already looking at that you need to address for the buildings?
No.
So are they looking at the physical, physical health of the building?
Yes. Yes.
So, but then you would say like the roof is 20 years old, for instance.
Yes.
Not, we're going to try to replace the roof in 10 years, but this is a 20-year-old roof.
Yes.
This is a 60-year-old water system or whatever.
Yes.
Okay.
We will make sure that they know that there's lead in the water, Kelly.
Well, and that we have capped and replaced.
Yes.
And
yes.
It's not impacting students adversely, but yes. Anything else, Dr. Doherty?
No, that's it. Thanks.
All right. Anything else from anyone this evening?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? We're adjourned.